Well, thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
I appreciate it. I mean, you know, your mom, your wife, daughter, friend, New York Times bestselling author. Congrats, by the way.
Thank you.
And so what would, you know, people say, what would someone as amazing as you, why would you even think about committing suicide for the first time at age 21?
At age 21, yeah. And, you know, my life didn't look then 20 years ago what it looks like now. But I think even then people would have said, why would somebody be like me? I was a college student. I was a high achiever. I was getting straight A's, was married. I thought I had my life all together. I was planning to go to law school. And it all sort of came crashing down my senior year of college. And I just got to a point where I decided I didn't want to live anymore, that I kind of went to almost an intellectual place with it, of thinking life had no meaning and I didn't want to go on. And there was a lot behind that, but for me it was just this overwhelming feeling of hopelessness that I there was no point.
Yeah, and here's the thing. I think Ruth said something very important. Nobody looks like the person you think is going to commit suicide. So I want those who are watching at home, nobody looks like the stereotype. People have an idea in their mind that this is what a person looks like that will commit suicide or be successful. I had I came into work one Friday several years ago, and I'm a gastroenterologist, and we work with anesthesiologists. And I walked in, and everybody looked grim and terrible. And I said, what happened? And I found out that one of our anesthesiologists took his life. So he was the life of the party, always the first one to be the most energetic, etc., but he took his life. And so it's really important. One of the things we're trying to, I think, let people know, there's not really a profile. A lot of us have an idea of what's going on. And you told me just a few minutes ago that there was a lot behind that. Tell me what was behind that decision.
There was a lot behind it. So when I was that senior year of college, I actually found out that a man who used to babysit me when I was younger had died. And it was almost like that unleashed something I was not expecting. And I started having all of these memories and flashbacks of being sexually abused when I was a kid for 4 years. It had
by
gone
that
on
man?
By that man.
Oh, wow.
But it wasn't until I was in college that he died that I started actually remembering it, because, and then I remembered how he had,
you'd put it out of your memory all the time.
Put it out of my memory. And he had threatened me and said he would kill my family and burn my house down. And so, you know, when you're a kid, that's how you cope, right? And
right. And
when he died, it sort of just, it all came spilling out. I started having nightmares. I started having flashbacks. And I didn't really know what to do with it all. And it was so emotionally hard to handle. And it felt like so much that was why I sort of went to this emotional place, or non-emotional place, of just saying, well, life has no meaning. So I'm just gonna end it all.
And I think folks who've never been where you are, it's so difficult to understand that you feel so devoid of hope that you say this is the only way out.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to talk about this more, but folks who are watching, you know, when you have this is a disease state. You know, it's not someone who's making a choice, and a lot of judgments are made. So it's incredibly important to understand. And in 2000, when you attempted suicide, fortunate for you and all of us who really are learning about your wisdom, you were unsuccessful. Tell me about what happened.
Yeah, well, I had multiple suicide attempts, actually, and, you know, then kind of devolved into this 2.5-year battle with depression and PTSD. And our system is so broken, so you go to a psychiatric hospital for help, but you don't get a lot of help, and then your insurance runs out and you get released. And so I think the second or third time I was released, I was very adamant that I was going to succeed. And so by then they were giving me a lot more prescription drugs and sleeping pills because I wasn't sleeping. And I one night took 6 bottles of prescription sleeping pills along with a bottle of vodka, and almost didn't make it on that one. And by the grace of God, I'm sitting here today. My therapist was actually the one who called, and he just had a feeling, you know, just one of those feelings that something was wrong. And he called me. It was like 10 o'clock at night, and I didn't answer the phone. And so he called 911, and the fire department broke down my door, and my heart stopped in the ambulance, and I was on life support with less than a 10% chance of waking up. And here I am. And they said, even if I woke up, I'd be brain damaged. And obviously that hasn't happened either. So it was a miracle that I'm still here.
By the grace of God. And here's the thing, you know, that the fact that you're unsuccessful is going to help so many thousands and hopefully millions of folks. We're going to take a break. When we come back, she's going to talk about how we will share a story of hope and of recovery. Please stay with us. Ruth will be right back with you.